Welcome back to New World Next Week. I'm James Corbett of CorbettReport.com.
And I'm James Evan Pilato of MediaMonarchy.com. Is your trash collector spying on you? We've got that story, plus still looking for some 9/11 truth. But first, less than 24 hours after formally certifying Iran's compliance with the P5+1 nuclear deal, the Trump administration announced a new round of sanctions against Iran nominally for having a ballistic missile program. This bizarre disconnect between reality and policy was prefaced in the statement confirming compliance, during which administration officials vowed Iran won't go unpunished for nonspecific allegations that they are violating the spirit of the deal. The Iranian foreign minister said that the U.S. has been in repeated violation of the P5+1 deal in preventing companies from doing business with Iran. They've repeatedly had to take the U.S. to joint commission to deal with and seek redress. They also warned that major U.S. violations could ultimately force Iran to withdraw from the deal, which possibly is the whole likely goal of the Trump administration's moves here in the first place. And we grab this article from antiwar.com and we grab it from Jason Ditz as these things are moving pretty quickly. So, James, where does this leave the Iran nuclear deal?
It leaves it exactly where the neocons and their ilk have been trying to steer it for years and years. Just type Bolton Iran deal into a search engine and you'll find years worth of stories of him saying, you must not go through with this deal. Okay, you've gone through this deal with its deal. You must renege it. You must scrap it now. And the bloodthirsty warmongering neocons have been railing against this for a very long time. And their strategy has always been, well, okay, let's put some sort of deal in front of them and then either make them go into noncompliance or allege that they've been in noncompliance. So that's where this is heading ultimately. And as I understand it, these are 90-day recertifications. These recertifications of compliance have to be done every 90 days. So 90 days from now, or 180 days from now, or 270 days from now, at some point down the line, they are not going to recertify. And we know this because, also reported on antiwar.com, is the fact that so Tillerson had to make his speech to Congress, giving certification, recertifying the deal on Monday. Before that point, Trump called it off and said, no, what are our options here? I don't want to recertify this deal, even though there is not one single thing that they have done in noncompliance with this deal. I don't want to recertify. And there's a big article about it on antiwar.com you can read through. And basically, Tillerson and McMaster had to plead and cajole and say, no, this is not in the national security interests of the United States to renege on a deal in which the other side is in 100% compliance, and had to do some arm twisting. So the delusional Trump voters who still believe that this is the Prince of Peace president who somehow is going to stop the U.S. from getting involved in wars, even though he fell hook, line, and sinker for the false flag chemical attack in Syria and dropped bombs because he saw dead children, so it must have been Assad, so let's drop bombs, and is absolutely foaming at the mouth to scrap this Iran deal in one form or another, despite the fact that Iran is in 100% compliance, shows that there is going to be more military involvement of the United States in a number of different theaters in the Middle East, despite whatever the lying psychopaths on the campaign trail promised the voters. And we have more to base this on. It's not just about Syria, it's about the entire region. Here's one from the American Conservative. Bannon and Kushner want to outsource Afghanistan to mercenaries. Yay! What could go wrong? Let's take this debacle, this 16-year now occupation of this country, based on what exactly again? Oh yes, Osama bin Laden was in Afghanistan, so we have to invade and occupy that country for decades and decades and decades, right? It's the longest war in the history of the United States. Still going. And now they're thinking about putting more troops in. Well, maybe we don't need to put more U.S. military troops in, we'll put more mercenaries in. And guess who's behind this? Eric Prince. If you don't know about Prince in the Trump administration, I suggest you type that into my search bar on CorbettReport.com and find out more about Eric Prince and what he's been suggesting. But as you know, founder of Blackwater, now connected with this Frontier Services Group based out of Hong Kong, maybe, theoretically. And, he's the one who's suggesting, hey guys, why don't you take mercenaries, and like the Frontier Services Group, and put them in Afghanistan? What could go wrong? So that's happening, and at the same time, the Free Thought Project has just reported that in 6 months, Trump has almost surpassed Obama's murderous record of killing innocent civilians in Iraq and Syria. That's right. In just 6 months, the Trump administration has killed 2,200 civilians in the Iraq-Syria area, whereas in the whatever 5 years or however many years of Obama's involvement there, there were 2,300 civilian deaths. And as that Free Thought Project article notes, in one of the bloodiest months of his presidency thus far, the Trump administration killed nearly 500 civilians in Syria between May 23rd and June 23rd. The largest death tolls were in the city of Deir Ezzor, with 222 civilian deaths, including 84 children, and Raqqa, with 250 civilian deaths, including 53 children. The U.S.-led coalition was also accused of using illegal chemicals such as white phosphorus, which is arguably grounds for a war crimes investigation. Do you think? Yeah, this is not the Prince of Peace presidency. This is not a president who is interested in keeping the U.S. out of foreign entanglements or stopping the U.S. military from taking over the world. This is just business as usual for the Pentagon. So you can guarantee in 90 or 180 or 270 days, whenever they think they have their ducks lined up, they're going to say they're going to not recertify this JCPOA with Iran. And I don't know what they're going to pull out of their hat. Oh, the Iran, they don't have the spirit of Christmas in their black Muslim hearts. Therefore, we won't recertify this deal. Whatever nonsense excuse they come up with, it will only be one step further on that road towards outright confrontation with Iran in the service mostly of Israeli slash neocon interests. That's what this is about. That's where this is heading. And Trump is no different than any of the other puppets before him.
And well, it's like Clyde Lewis says, it's business as usual in the apocalypse. And all these neocon cronies have all come back and infested the swamp as though they ever had actually left the swamp. But maybe people don't know about Eric Prince because, of course, the paradigm shifts, the pendulum kind of swings a little bit. It's his sister that's taking all the flack right now. That's right. She is the head of the Department of Education. So all the cronies, all the people are still there. Sometimes the last names are a little bit different, but if you kind of scratch below the surface, you'll see that, yeah. Again, these guys are all cronily connected. So, James, speaking of national security concerns, and speaking of what you said is the longest American war in history, based on Osama being in Afghanistan, and why do we care about Osama? Because he allegedly did 9/11, right? So our second story this week takes us over to the UK via the London Independent as 9/11 survivors urge Prime Minister May to release that suppressed Saudi terror report. Survivors of the 9/11 attacks have written to Prime Minister Theresa May, urging her to make public a British government report into the extent of Saudi Arabia's funding of Islamist extremism in the UK. The report into the significance of the financing of Islamist extremists in Britain by Saudi Arabia and other nations was commissioned by Ms. May's predecessor, David Cameron, as part of a deal to obtain political support for a parliamentary vote on UK airstrikes on Syria. See, this is all part of the rich tapestry. Last week, British Home Secretary Amber Rudd said the report wasn't being published, quote, because of the volume of personal information it contains and for national security reasons. Now, a group representing U.S. survivors of the 9/11 attacks and the relatives of some of the dead have urged Ms. May to seize the chance to release the report, even if it's not fully complete. Now, the Independent actually goes on to say, many believe Britain and the U.S. share a long history of promoting and using extremists when it has benefited their strategic, economic, or military goals. This is not the first time that a British government has sought to protect strategic ties with Saudi Arabia by covering up embarrassing or damaging information. In 2006, Tony Blair halted a major criminal investigation into alleged corruption by BAE and payments to Saudi officials after it was decided continuing the probe would endanger Britain's security, the same excuse cited now in the present day in 2017 by Ms. Rudd. James, I don't actually put a ton of faith on this actually happening, but maybe, but sometimes when the little critters are all cornered, they can act out in wild ways to kind of save their butts. Maybe sometimes when the government gangsters are fighting each other, we might win with some bit of collateral damage info that might come out. Is that too hopeful on my part?
Well, it certainly is hopeful. It does happen from time to time, you are correct, so we shouldn't just dismiss it entirely, but it is rather hopeful, and I imagine that if this does come out in any form, it won't come out unless and until all of the links to the U.S. government, to the British government, to the Israeli government are expunged and removed from this document. And then maybe they might bring it out. But of course, then what would it actually be except just a paper veneer of a couple of links here and there? No, the real point of this is that when they point the finger at Saudi Arabia, there's at least four fingers pointing back at them. And that's why these types of reports are not released or are heavily redacted, etc. As I've talked about many times, the whole Saudi 9/11 story is not exactly a red herring, but it certainly does. If it's just looked at as Saudi Arabia, these guys did all of this. No, you have to look at the links back. And if you do need to connect those links back between Saudi and the U.S. Government and 9/11, I will direct your attention to a Kevin Ryan article on digwithin.net, Saudi ties to 9/11 mean U.S. ties to 9/11. And he goes through point by point lots of different points of how this all connects back to the people who obviously clearly enabled 9/11 to happen in the first place, going all the way from Al-Hazmi and Al-Maidar living with an FBI informant when they came to the U.S., and to Brandar Bush, obviously, Prince Bandar being closely connected to the Bush family, and having his personal attorney being Louis Free, the ex-director of the FBI. I mean, all of these crazy connections, the corporate connections with Kroll and Stratisek and Sake and all these corporations that are up to their eyeballs in 9/11, all of these show multiple ties between the highest levels of the Saudi, where the financing and things presumably came through, and the highest levels of the U.S. government that allowed or enabled or helped these events to occur. And of course, none of that addresses some of the core issues, like, did the Saudi government wire WTC7 to go down? No, of course not. So, again, I think it misses the point if we put all of our eggs in that basket. But, as I say, from time to time, some of this information does come out in a way that we can at least piece the pieces together, even if they never will explicitly do so themselves. So, hopefully, some crumbs fall from that table. But I don't think that's where we have to, you know, put all of our hopes and energies into waiting for that to happen from on high.
So I think to continue talking about 9/11, I was actually going to say this back when we were still kind of talking about Trump. We're in, and I kind of realize now, James, as you were talking, we're 6 months now to the day of Trump's inauguration, I believe. I believe it was January 20th. So now we are 6 months exactly later. And I still worry. You know, I think there's probably generally some kind of big terror event kind of waiting in the wings during the first year of any new puppet president's administration. And it kind of realigns everything, and all the previous problems and bickering will generally kind of go away. And so there's a part of me that's kind of bracing for whatever on earth that might be. And I think all of the kind of pre-moves that we talk about here on the shows, once we have the 2020 hindsight of whatever this event may turn out to be, we'll probably be able to look and see, oh, see, they were putting all their ducks in a row, whether it was Syria or Iran or whatever the proxy war game is going to be. So we cover a lot of high-tech ways that the powers that shouldn't be spy on all of us. But for our final story this week, for New World Next Week, episode 317, we take a pretty low-tech way, but it stinks just as much, if I may be so punny. The city of Ogden, Utah, recently joined an increasingly popular program developed by Trash Collection Behemoth Waste Management Corporation, and it's called the Waste Watch Driver Training Program. This article originally coming from the New American. But here's how Waste Management Corporation's website describes the program. Quote, our trucks are on your streets every day. Our drivers are familiar with their routes, so they're often the first to notice when something is amiss. As your community partner, we assist local police and fire departments by acting as extra eyes and ears on local streets. Through our Waste Watch program, we provide training to our drivers in what to look for and how to report suspicious or criminal activity to local authorities. According to the local report coming from KSL out of Ogden, Utah, several other cities in Utah have started the program the same week as Ogden. They just kind of seem to be the front man for it, joining a claimed 270 other communities nationwide that are participating in the Waste Watch Driver Training Program. So what is in this fantastic training program, you ask? Well, KSL says, quote, the workers watch a 15-minute video explaining the do's and don'ts of helping keep watch in neighborhoods they serve and how to report an emergency, end quote. James, there's also a bit of suspicion that city waste management companies have been installing automatic license plate readers in garbage trucks. I've got a story from Blacklisted News going back to 2015. Police and Homeland Security using 200,000 garbage trucks to spy on the U.S. So pretty obviously, whether it's the border or the doctor's office or online, everywhere, everything, all the time, it's pretty much total information awareness. Or, just as we, I think, have talked about even as recently as last week, what if the license plate readers on the trash trucks are even maybe like those imaginary BBC detector vans that we talked about last summer, James? Do you really think? I do not put it past trashmen spying. And, of course, in a lot of these situations, you hear the saying of, you know, if you give somebody a hammer, all they're going to see is nails when they walk around. So you kind of set these guys loose, and I don't know what to think, James.
Well, that was a nice callback to the BBC detector van story that we covered last year, so I hope you'll throw a link in so people can rewatch that. But I think that might be along the lines of this. It's not necessarily that these garbage men are now super, super deputized policemen that are looking and spying on you in that degree of detail. A 15-minute instructional video that they're forced to watch, you know, is probably not going to change their lives or change the way they operate for the most part. But I think you're right. It's the idea that they're putting out to the public now. Look at all these garbage men. They're watching what you do, too. They're watching your garbage to see what you're doing. And you're right. It's the doctors and the lawyers and the computer repairmen. Everyone spying on what you're doing secretly for the government, right? And it's this idea of either outright deputization or secret deputization. And if people don't remember the InfraGuard idea program that is still in operation today, they've deputized tens of thousands of people in the private sector to work for FBI/DHS in spying on the public and reporting on suspicious events and all of that. Again, it's the idea of kind of deputizing everyone as a way of drawing them all into this homeland security concept. It's not a homeland unless everybody's on board and everybody's spying on everyone. It is the Stasi, you know, East German police state, and that is absolutely the model that they are explicitly working on. If you look at the creation of DHS and the people who were involved in that, absolutely, they were explicitly looking at the East German police state. But that's what they're doing, and they're trying to make everyone part of this and bring everyone on board. And it's the idea that everyone is watching you at all times, that they're putting out there with stories like this one, that I think is probably more important than what any individual garbage man is doing on his daily rounds.
It is, maybe it boils down to that sort of fundamental and almost ancient idea of the panopticon. I'm not sure if I'm being watched. I think I might be being watched, so I'm going to act like I'm being watched, and therefore everybody censors not only what they do, but then they start to censor their mind, and then we're in, of course, complete dystopic land. So that's a hell of a way to wrap up this New World Next Week episode. In closing, we discuss, I think, a lot of the stories here before they kind of hit prime time. James, I think you can look now and see asset forfeiture finally in the mainstream news right now. So I'll put out to people right there, if you find these shows helpful, we hope that you will help us out by supporting our independent, non-commercial work. James.
All right, let's do it again next week. James, thank you for three great stories.
Thanks, buddy. Take care.